Will you allow me to rant for just a moment? It was a hypothetical question. I'm going to do so whether you like it or not. Writing is really hard. It takes talent, creativity, wisdom, and life experience. Everyone wants writers with 5 years of experience or whatever, but few are actually willing to give you a chance to get said experience. You often only get one shot at things, and you're only as good as your most recent project. And the worst of it is that there's countless lame brains out there who think because they own a word processor and a keyboard, they're suddenly Tolkien or something. And digging through the crap to get to the good stuff turns a lot of people off, making it harder for those trying to get discovered. And then you've got to worry if anything you wrote is going to offend someone. And trust me, someone will find a reason to be offended. Okay, rant over. Now, enjoy the satire about writing for television.
Maybe it's right up my alley. Maybe it and me can go together.
Well, that's the point. You see, this particular series and you go together like the black and tan at an Irish Republican Army picnic. The series happens to be about black magic, conjuring, that kind of thing. Now, what do you know about black magic? Oh,
what do I know about it? What do I know about black magic and conjuring? Oh, come on. I could research it.
Julius, will you leave me now, please? Will you let me get back to my work?
Oh, let me have a try at this series, please. Why can't I research it? Look, Mr. Hugo, my career is on the line. Give me till next Wednesday. Make it Tuesday? Look, we're getting a pinch. I'll have something for you by Monday.
All right, Julius. Latch onto a couple of books, knock out a rough draft, and let me have it by 4 o'clock Monday.
The Bard was directed by David Butler and written by Rod Serling. We're writing a masterpiece along with Julius Moomer, played by Jack Weston. He's a bumbling hack writer who probably thinks Roald Dahl is a girl's toy that spins around on the floor. I'll give you a moment to absorb that joke. Anyways, Julius has tried again and again to sell his terrible scripts through an agent to anyone who will buy them. Honestly, some of them sound better than actual episodes of this program, so that's an added layer of humour for me. And yes, this is another comedy episode, except this time, it's actually funny. Now that's a twist. A lot of comedy comes down to timing, and this episode has perfect timing on almost every delivery. The scene I showed you was all about Julius finding out that a television network is looking for a writer for a new show about black magic. Julius manages to persist long enough and get a chance to submit a pilot script. And off he goes to the used bookstore to see what he can find on the subject. When he gets there, he sees a sign about Keats and asks for one as if it was a thing and not a person, showing his ineptitude. The owner tells him they don't have any books on black magic, until one just flies off the shelf and lands at their feet. Freaked out, the owner just lets him have it and rushes him out of the store. He practices on the bus until he gets kicked off, and then practices in his apartment, which brings the attention of a young girl who lives in his building and is apparently chummy with him. Was friendship with a kid in your apartment just really common back then? Anyways, he shares his predicament with her.
I'm conjuring, baby, I'm conjuring!
Conjuring who?
Who knows? I just read this here book and I got me all the ingredients, or most of them anyway. Yeah. 4 tufts of feathers from a falcon. I got them from a pigeon. Sand from Egypt. I still had some in my sneakers from Jones Beach. 3 legs of a spider. I found me an ant. Well, anyway, that with a few improvisations, I got me a spell working here.
When my mother finds out what you're doing, you better conjure up the Army and the Navy. You're gonna need them.
Anyone ever tell you you were a dirty, rotten kid?
Why don't you go take a cold shower?
Go ahead, get out of here. I'll turn you into a frog. I don't know exactly what's gonna happen, but it better happen soon.
Thank you.
Zazazoom. Alakazam. Vavavoom.
He throws his hands in the air, both literally and figuratively, and sits down in front of a typewriter, completely bummed. And then he says something about them wanting him to be William Shakespeare. And suddenly, the playwright is standing before him, dressed in very colourful clothing. This is indeed William Shakespeare, played by John Williams. He at once is aware that he has been summoned by magical means, and that he is in the year 1963. And he offers his services to Julius for whatever it is he needs. After Julius faints and gets over the fact that Shakespeare is in his living room, he gets to work asking Shakespeare for help in writing. Julius decides to not waste him on this pilot, and instead asks him to pen an hour-long film script for an anthology show. I see what you did there, Mr. Serling. Julius says they'll collaborate, but that ultimately boils down to Will doing the work, and Julius imagining his name up in lights. After it's written, we see a scene with Julius back in the agent's office, meeting the network bigwigs and the sponsors. And if there was any doubt Mr. Serling wrote this in part to rant about dumb executives, I present Exhibit A.
The Shannon Food Corporation, you've no doubt eaten their products.
Endlessly. This boy's a Shannon booster from way back.
Oh, man, like that's the whole truth. Well, that Shannon onion soup, this I dig.
We don't make onion soup. That's French in origin. We're an American firm, red, white, and blue, right down the line.
Man, I am glad you said that. I always say if it's good enough for the lady in Dubuque, it's good enough for Julius. Well, let's get down to some business here.
In the end, they go forward with the film, and we see a scene where Julius is brought onto a talk show to talk about his new script, which of course he takes old credit for. I assume this section is a stab at those who have ripped off of other writers and claimed all the credit. We certainly see a lot of that in creative endeavours. Every new story is almost always inspired by something else. And I think it's really important to acknowledge that. Anyways, Shakespeare mentions that he will show up to watch the rehearsals tomorrow, as that will determine whether he sticks around to keep helping Julius. Julius is mortified that Shakespeare will rock the boat, but can't actually stop him. We see him change the rehearsal space, and see the director, actors, and the suits sitting on one side along with Julius. We have some funny exchanges here, with Mr. Serling taking shots at everyone in the room. He shows the corporate sponsor as a pig-headed idiot by having him ask when the commercial comes on, and when it's mentioned that they hired the great Rocky Rhodes to play the lead, he says, "Rhodes Schmodes, I sell soup. I don't know about actors." Best line in the episode. He also takes a stab at the flaky, artsy actors out there, with Rhodes' character, played by Burt Reynolds.
Question.
Question, Rocky?
Yeah, I mean, what is my tertiary motivation here? I mean, like, I walk through the door, and I see her. Why?
Why what, Rocky? What's the question?
Exactly. What is the question? I mean, like, any slob can walk through a door. I mean, like I do it every day. But, well, now, maybe I shouldn't walk through the door at that moment. So I gotta ask myself, would I walk through that door? It's on the basis of that answer that I find my motivation. So the question is, what's my motivation?
Well, Rocky, baby, why don't we just run through it and see how it plays? Shall we do that?
Shakespeare makes his appearance and is mortified to learn the lead is being played by such a fruitcake, and almost every scene in the story has been changed for one reason or another. Almost every twist and turn has been altered in some way, some in ways that ruin the story. Two examples on the spectrum. A dramatic suicide scene is removed to be more conservative, and a line about pain in the gut is cut because the sponsor doesn't want his soup to be associated with upset stomachs. Shakespeare throws a fit as his beautiful work is destroyed before his eyes for the sake of corporate appeasement and starts to storm out, but not before knocking Rhodes out and delivering a final soliloquy.
Blow, blow, thou winter wind, thou art not so unkind as man's ingratitude. That's from As You Like It, Act 2, Scene 7.
Hey, Will! Hey, wait a minute, Will! Wait a minute! What are you doing? You're gonna house up the whole deal? What am I gonna say to him in there? What am I gonna tell him?
Tell them simply that foolery, sir, does walk about the orb like the sun. It shines everywhere. Act 3, Scene 1, Twelfth Night. And you, Julius Moomer, foolish mortal who could have covered himself with a cloak of immortality. To you, Julius Moomer, who has succumbed to the rankest compound of villainous smell that ever offended nostril. To you, Julius Moomer, lots of luck.
The television movie ends up being a success, and of course, the network wants more. But without Shakespeare, Julius is clueless. And the next special is on American history. So with a devious smile, he summons up Abraham Lincoln, Benjamin Franklin, and a host of other ghosts to do his dirty work. I never thought an episode summarized as "A Hack Writer Enlists the Help of Shakespeare" could be good, but it is. Was it predictable? Yes. I had every plot point guessed, but it was witty, well-paced, and legitimately funny. It was a satire on executive meddling and the changes that are made to a writer's vision, and it succeeds at that. But it also delivers a message about giving credit where credit is due, and admitting when you're in over your head. All in all, a solid tale that earns 2 out of 3 fedoras from me.